Evening. Oh, great, wonderful. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Miho Walsh, and I'm the Executive Director of the Asian Cultural Council, and it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you here tonight. At the ACC, we are all about fostering meaningful cultural connections and building lasting relationships. The ACC is the vision of John D. Rockefeller III, who believed that culture played a significant and guiding role in creating a more peaceful and better world. His idea was to identify and invest in exceptional individuals and through their work create greater understanding and connection between people. He was convinced that this person-to-person connection would advance international dialogue, respect, and mutual understanding. With great confidence in the power of the individual, we began our work in 1963. And since then, ACC has awarded nearly 6,000 grants to individual artists, cultural scholars, and cultural institutions working in 20 different disciplines and in 25 different countries. The ACC Fellowship is a deeply immersive one, whereby the rich discovery of spending time in a different culture and cultural setting enables not only sharing and learning of another culture, but transformation of oneself. Today, the idea of connection is widespread. In fact, the world is far more connected today than it has ever been. At the click of a button, we can friend somebody halfway across the world and send them a photo instantly. But in this day of advanced technology and opportunity to exchange, there are equally strong forces that pull us apart. And what is going to overcome these negative forces and resolve conflict in the world is deeper understanding and respect among people. Tonight, it is with this commitment to promoting the values of cultural exchange and securing a better world that I am particularly excited to welcome you to our inaugural East-West Dialogue. This new event series was conceived as a platform to engage distinguished thought leaders from the art and cultural fields to encourage critical and new thinking, and to promote mutual understanding. Importantly, I would like to acknowledge and extend our profound thanks to Shoji and Tsuneko Sadao, whose generous endowment gift makes this ongoing series at the Asian Cultural Council possible. And now I am honored to introduce our distinguished speakers, whose professional and personal lives represent a lifelong dialogue between East and West. Ian Buruma was born in the Netherlands to a British mother and a Dutch father. He was educated in Holland and Japan, studying history, Chinese literature, and Japanese cinema. In the 1980s, he worked as a journalist, spending much of his career traveling and reporting from all over Asia, and notably serving in Hong Kong as the cultural editor of the Far Eastern Economic Review. He has published 18 books and is a frequent contributor to publications in the Americas, Europe, and Asia, and his works have been recognized by numerous awards. In 2008 and 2010, he was voted as one of the top 100 public intellectuals by Foreign Policy and Prospect magazines. Currently, he is the Paul W. Williams Professor of Democracy, Human Rights, and Journalism at Bard College. Pico Iyer was born in England to parents from India and was educated at Eton, Oxford, and Harvard. He is known for traveling to every corner of the world to write on globalism, travel, culture, politics, literature, and much more. He has been a writer for Time magazine since 1982, and since 1992, he has based his home in rural Japan. The author of 10 books, he is a prolific contributor to numerous international publications, regularly participates as a TED Talk speaker, and annually seeks the quiet of a Benedictine Hermitage in California. The spirit of tonight's event is one of openness and exploration and connection. We will have a short Q&A at the end of the dialogue. And before we begin, if I could kindly remind everybody to just turn off their phones. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in extending our warmest welcome to Ian Buruma and Pico Iyer.
Thank you, Miho, and thank you all for joining us. I think I can say on Ian's behalf as well as mine that we're really happy and privileged to be able to advance the Asian Cultural Council's commitment to dialogue. And for me, it's especially fun to get to see Ian, because all our meetings partake of something a bit miraculous. The last time I saw Ian was in New Delhi Airport, as I was about to get on a plane for Jaipur, and I walked right into Ian, who was on the same plane. The second last time...
Same festival, so it wasn't that miraculous.
No, but I wasn't expecting to see you that early. The festival hadn't begun. The second one was more miraculous, maybe, because I was cowering with a friend in a darkened basement bar at the American Colony Hotel in East Jerusalem, and suddenly I heard, Pico! And it was Ian who walked in with a friend. Ian was living in Jerusalem at the time and had just been in the West Bank. I was staying in a hospice in the Old City. And the third last time I saw Ian was when I took my mother and some friends of hers out to her 80th birthday party in Santa Barbara, California. And we ended up at exactly the same table as Ian, who was being feted by his hosts prior to giving a talk at the university. And my mother and her friends and I kind of reveled away for 3 hours. Then we stumbled into the parking lot at the end of the evening, and we walked into Ian again. And it was rather illustrative because I'd spent the whole evening just eating and gossiping, and he'd been illuminating the local community with his lecture. And we first met 28 years ago when, improbably, we were both covering the Summer Olympics in Seoul, South Korea. And I had just brought out a rather juvenile book about speeding through 10 countries in Asia called Video Night in Kathmandu. And Ian was just completing a much more rigorous and sophisticated rendition of the same theme called God's Dust. And I've often been tickled by the fact that Ian, of course, is of entirely European descent, but as you know, he, and as you just heard from Miho, he speaks Chinese and Japanese, he studied in Japan, he has a distinguished Japanese historian for a wife. And I think if I'm trying to follow the shifting politics of Japan or the history or Japan's relation to nationalism, there's no writer in English that I would turn to before Ian. While I have been based in Japan, as you heard, for 28 years, but all on a tourist visa, I speak very limited Japanese, and I just try to watch the country kind of unfold in my local neighborhood. But Ian is entirely of European descent, but can tell us about Japan from within. I'm entirely of Asian descent, but the only country I can describe from within is England. So East and West have probably almost ceased to have meaning or dissolved into one another. But since this is the ACC, I thought the natural place to begin, Ian, would be to say, or to ask you, what is it that you have got from travel that you haven't got from your reading and research? Because I know you do a lot of both of those.
Well, before answering the question, I think you should describe our first meeting in Seoul during the Olympics, because I was deeply impressed, and this says a lot about your identity, I suppose, which was in a coffee shop in Seoul. And South Korea was more remote in those days than it is now. And Pico asked the waitress in the coffee shop, who didn't speak a word of English, of course, whether they had Earl Grey tea. Of course, now they probably would say, you know, do you mean Fulton and Mason, sir, or Gives of Cambridge? But in those days, this was a truly eccentric question to ask in a Seoul coffee shop. So a true Elditonian, I thought.
You're lucky it wasn't McDonald's I took you to.
But yes, indeed, that would have been. But the question... what does travel? Well, I'm a great admirer of V.S. Naipaul's writing on non-Western countries, the Middle East, Asia, Africa, and so on. And the main reason I'm a great admirer is because he's a master of description, and he doesn't like abstractions. He likes to he describes what he sees with his eyes and hears and smells and so on, which gives a very vivid account of the experiences he has in these countries. At the same time, of course, he has a very inquiring mind, so it's not just describing visual sensations. But it's that kind of writing that grips me. I'm not terribly interested in abstractions. I don't understand theory. It's way over my head. As soon as people talk about narrativization and othering and so on, they've lost me. But I do like the sensual experience of being in other places and meeting people and listening to how they talk, and not only what they say, but how they say it and so on. So I think for that kind of writing, it's essential that you get away from your desk.
Yeah. And my personal prejudice is that these days, the more we hear about a country, actually the less we know about it. That in some ways it's everything essential about a place that somehow gets lost in either the media or the screens. And I agree with you entirely, because I was recently in Iran and in Kashmir, and I was reading Naipaul in both cases. And he always protests that he's not interested in theorizing, he's just giving the facts. And I think he does. He's a perfect guide in some ways to Kashmir even now, 50 years after his first
yes,
book.
Yes, although like most writers, I suppose, he does have one, I don't know whether to call it a tick, but he does tend slightly to project his own vision of a place onto people he talks to. Mm. So for example, I think it was a book about India called A Million Mutinies Now, and he has a technique which is to have a local person who will guide him around, and usually often not to the shock of that person, the life story of that person that he's dragged out of them will end up as the main story in the book. And he was in Lucknow, and there was a young Muslim Indian who, intellectual I think, who sort of guides him around the town. And in the book, he describes how this young Muslim Indian has a deep, deep melancholy. He always repeats himself, a deep melancholy about the lost culture of his ancestors. And apparently, this man read the book later and said, I've never felt melancholic about that in my life. But it's Naipaul himself, yeah, of course, who is always full of deep melancholy about lost cultures.
Yes. Yeah, no, we create the places we visit. I think all of us do.
It's hard
to absent oneself. But do you remember specific moments when, let's say, when you first went to Japan that suddenly opened a door to you that you'd never suspected prior to arrival?
Well, there were so many moments that I can't really single out one. I suppose before I went to Japan, and one of the reasons I got interested in Japan, and this may be rather unrelated, well, it is an East-West dialogue of a kind. I didn't grow up ever thinking about Asia at all. And growing up in Holland, and when I was young, about the only decent food you can get in Holland was Indonesian food, and it was usually Chinese-Indonesian. So I liked that. So that was I knew that about Asia. I didn't have any other knowledge of it. And the first time I really came across people of Asian descent was in the United States. Mm-hmm. And it was my first visit to the United States in 1970. And I went to California, to Los Angeles. And it's the only time in my life that I think I felt true culture shock. It wasn't in Tokyo or New Delhi or Seoul or even Pyongyang. It was in LA. I'd never seen such a thing. I'd seen it in the movies, but it was, for a European, a truly weird city. I liked it, but it was sort of astonishing and shocking and so on. And my friend, the two friends I made there, were Japanese Americans, were Bruce and Norman Yonemoto, who then later became quite well-known video artists and so on. And one thing that left an impression on me, and I think that was the sort of the seed that was sown for my later interest in Asia, I was not then planning to study Chinese at all, was when we did the entirely conventional thing for young people in 1970. We went to Disneyland on acid. This is what one did. And this led to very earnest discussions about the meaning of life and culture and so on and so forth. And I remember the Onimoto brothers having a heated discussion about the ancestry, culture, blah, blah, blah. Norman, the elder brother, had absolutely no interest in Japan whatsoever. He was interested in boys, and he was interested in films, and he was interested in life in California. Bruce, we could get very earnest, especially on acid, was sort of going on and on about, you know, how the culture of Japan and Asia was running through their veins and so on. And I was the sort of the bystander listening to this. But it made an impression. And so when I went back to Holland to study, and I didn't know what I wanted to study, it was that, and it was meeting Indian friends in London, also in 1970, who were tremendously successful with girls because they would sort of look spiritual and sort of say India a lot and play Ravi Shankar, and the girls were like putty in their hands. And so it was these two impressions that I think were the true basis of my involvement in Asia.
Well, I've been thinking about it today because I'm staying just 5 blocks away from where I used to work in New York City 33 years ago, and I was remembering, and this is a poignant contrast with your experience, because in 1983, I took my first trip ever to Southeast Asia, and I went for 4 weeks to Thailand, Burma, Hong Kong, and Macau. And each one of them was more extraordinary than anything I had imagined. And each day is still indelibly impressed on me. I can tell you almost what I was doing on October 11th, 1983. And I was flying with Japan Airlines, and when I was flying back from Hong Kong to JFK, I had an overnight layover in Narita Airport near Tokyo, which, of course, I didn't want, but that was the way that it was ticketed. And so Japan Airlines put me up in a hotel at Narita, and I woke up and I had breakfast, and I had 5 hours to kill before my 2 a.m. flight. And I thought, what am I going to do here? And I saw this little sign offering a free shuttle bus to the town of Narita. And I thought, you know, I know airport towns. I've been to Queens. I've spent a lot of time in Inglewood near LAX. I've spent a lot of time in Hounslow near Heathrow. What can an airport town have to offer? But I also thought, you know, I'm probably never going to be in Japan again, so there's nothing else on my agenda. So I don't know if you've ever taken this trip, but I got on the bus, I got off 20 minutes later. It deposited me at this very narrow lane of entirely wooden houses with tatami mats, shoes laid out perfectly outside. Most of them were coffee shops, restaurants of one kind or another. I could see the first touch of red and yellow, orange through the windows. Everything still and impeccable in that Japanese way. Followed the riddle of lanes down to this amazing 1,000-year-old temple. Narita is actually one of the great pilgrimage sites of Japan, with a garden huger than a park, where little kids in... couldn't be further from acid on Disneyland. I was looking at little kids in yellow hats, kindergartners, collecting acorns. And this was late October day, which means in Japan, blue skies, but the first pinch and sting of autumn in the air. And by the time I boarded my flight at 1:15, on the basis of 4 hours in Narita, I decided to move to Japan. And it took me 3 years to navigate it, but I did, and I've been there 28 years. And it's strange, because now I think about it, and the trip was to all those other places, and each of those places was more radiant than I could have expected, and yet it was the airport layover.
Did you get Earl Grey tea?
Now, you see, Ian's great theme as a writer is Englishness. That's why you picked up on that topic, right?
No, I can describe my first trip to Japan, too, because it was in 1974 in the summer, and we flew with Pakistan Airlines because that was the cheap airline, and a good airline too. And in those days, of course, it was never a direct flight, so you stopped in Tehran and I think Lahore, and then Bangkok, and then Manila, and then Tokyo. And the plane broke down in Bangkok, so the first night in Asia was in Bangkok. They had to get another engine or something.
At an airport hotel again?
At an airport. No, it was in the middle of... No, it was called the First Hotel in Bangkok. Huh. And what was so impressive is that it started off looking unbelievably exotic, especially in Lahore. And you got out of the plane and everybody was in kurtas and so on. It was a completely different world. And then you got into Bangkok, which was also quite exotic. Manila, slightly less exotic. And then you landed in Tokyo, where everybody suddenly wore the same clothes and listened to the same rock music and so on. And yet, it was probably the strangest place of all.
Yes.
And that's, in some ways, the fascination of Japan. I mean, I was never interested in what used to be called the third world. I mean, places that were sort of exotically poor and so on. I found Japan fascinating because it was not poor. It was wealthy, even in the 70s already. And modern, clearly very modern, more modern in many ways than Europe was. And yet very strange.
Yes.
and strange in the sense of having a very different culture and tradition and so on. And it was that combination, I think, that gripped me. Mm. Whereas China in those days, well, it was not a particularly attractive or inviting place. It was still at the end of the Cultural Revolution. And unless you were an official friend of the people, you couldn't even go there. But that really didn't attract me at all. It was it was the modernity of Japan that I found so compelling.
Yeah. Well, that's actually one reason why I'm still there on a tourist visa, because I know however deeply I was into the culture, it's still unreadable. And it's an ideal place to be a bewildered, fascinated tourist. But I wouldn't necessarily want to be Japanese or to be engaged in the Japanese system. But
the chances of you becoming Japanese are very slim.
Yeah, well, exactly. They're zero, which is why it's better even to, you know, to make.
But the word unreadable is interesting.
Because, don't you think?
Well, my great mentor in Japan, Donald Ritchie, who spoke perfectly well but never learned to read Japanese.
Yeah.
And Ed Seidensticker, the great translator and scholar and so on, once, and friend of Donald Ritchie, once said to him, Donald, I think you're lucky that you don't read Japanese. Because all those letters you see in neon and so on, they look beautiful and graceful and exotic. And you can't see that they're just commercials for toothpaste.
Yeah.
And so
yes.
There is a sort of a strangeness and mystery if you can't read things.
Yes.
Once you can read things, they literally become readable.
Yes. But do you feel you've got a grip on Japan, or do you...
Well, I have a grip.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean to say I understand everything or know always how to behave appropriately or want to. A grip, yeah, I can't say that I find it deeply mysterious or it's or in some way utterly inscrutable. None of those things. I think... That depends so much on language.
Yeah.
And you could go to the strangest place and stay with a remote tribe somewhere. If you speak their language, it suddenly becomes much less strange and unfathomable than otherwise.
Which may be why I think Japan, more than most places, is either misrepresented or misunderstood outside Japan. In other words, the notion that we have sitting in New York City of Japan is more different from the reality, in my experience, than with India, say, or Thailand, or other of the Asian countries. Wouldn't you say that?
Mm.
The relation of surface and depth, I find, more complex in Japan than anywhere I've been, especially India, say.
I don't know if I really think that. I mean, also, the thing about, you can talk about cultures, different countries, and so on. When you spend time in a place, of course, you gravitate to the same sort of people that you gravitate anywhere else. So the kind of friends that I made in Tokyo when I lived there were the sort of people I would have also hung out with if I'd been in New York or Paris. I mean, in terms of interests, shared interests, and so on. And so that already makes it the experience much less strange.
Yeah.
So I can't say that I find, well, I mean, it would be weird for me to say I find Japan stranger than India or Thailand, since much of my adult life has been spent in such intimacy with Japan. Mm. I mean, I'm married to a Japanese and so on. So no, I don't find it strange. I do think it's true to say that the Japanese, rather like the English, because of their insularity and their relative isolation from the sort of continental culture, have a certain eccentricity about them that continental cultures don't. Mm. And it's, of course, what makes it fascinating, too. And some people find that deeply irritating, just as many people find the English deeply irritating. But it's precisely what makes those places compelling, to me.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what I was going to say, which is before I went to Japan, I'd read up, as most of us have, a lot of it. I had some sense of what to expect. But I wasn't expecting such idiosyncrasy, such kindness, or such passion. And I think those If somebody were to ask me what Japan is like today, those might be some of the qualities that first come to my mind, which are very different from, I think, the popular conception of Japan, which is formed much more by a collective and corporate Japan or Japanese people in groups. And I think, again, the difference between a Japanese group and a Japanese individual is more pronounced than maybe between an Indian group and an Indian individual. And it's interesting, of course, I'm married to a Japanese too, but we very quickly realized that my wife is the Indian in the household and I'm the Japanese, and I think it's often works that way. And of course, she was fascinated by the world I was fleeing and vice versa. And the one difference is that I'm in suburban Nara and I haven't been much in Tokyo, so actually the people I hang out with are very different from the people I know in New York or London, because it's mostly retired people. It's almost as if I found myself in an old age community there. And my one form of discourse, not being very fluent, is playing ping pong with them. So it's a different window on
very
Japan.
Different, yeah. I didn't spend much time playing ping pong with retired people when I was there. Just to carry on a little bit with the analogy with England, you're quite right. The popular image of Japan is, of course, of this rather conformist people and men in their sort of blue serge suits and their ties and rather po-faced and so on. But of course, countries that are societies that are relatively conformist, and England would be one too, usually produce mavericks and eccentrics who are truly eccentric. Mm. And the aspects of Japan that always fascinated me most or attracted me most are not quite the same ones that you mentioned. In the Taisho period, in the 1920s in Japan, there was a fashion for something that was called ero-guro nonsense, erotic, grotesque, absurd, which was very much the culture of the 20s in Japan, and rather outrageous, crazy, and so on. And there is, when I was there in the 70s, or lived there in the 70s, there was still a very strong element of ero-guro nonsense, a lot of it from the 60s still. And the Japanese had their versions of the hippies called futenzoku. And I once saw somebody, a hippie with kind of with torn jeans and long hair and so on, and he had very neatly stenciled on his denim jacket, "I am Japanese hippie." So that wasn't quite the same thing. Not quite head culture in Haight-Ashbury, but in any case, there was a lot of that kind of eroguro nonsense. And it's the sort of the other side of Japanese conformity. It's the non-conformists that I always found really interesting. And I think if you look at Japanese writing, Japanese film, and so on, it's the non-conformism that is so interesting, because precisely because society is conformist.
Yeah.
And so they're rebelling against something, yes. And of course rebels are always the only people worth knowing.
I mean, it's a country of hobbyists, I think, and people
also, well,
privately have
like
extraordinary
Orwell
passions.
About England, the nation of pigeon fanciers.
Yeah, and we were talking backstage about Kazuo Ishiguro, the great English-Japanese novelist, and you know that if you want to understand Englishness, you read his first two books about Japan, and if you want to understand Japan, you read Remains of the Day or his work set in England. He's working at exactly that pivot. And it's funny, when you were talking about 1974, probably as you were in that plane or in the first hotel in Bangkok, I was remembering that was the time when my parents took me around India, which I'd never actually seen, and where I'm to this day an even more bewildered, sometimes startled tourist. And I met all my relatives, and I spent a whole summer staying in their houses, where the Earl Grey tea was extremely good, of course.
I'm sure.
And the number one bestseller then as now was P.G. Wodehouse, and I got a much stronger dose of Englishness in India than I ever had back in England. And when I went back to England for school, of course, I was a little embarrassed to have been spending the whole summer with my parents, meeting uncles and aunts, but the only way I could justify it was exactly what you were experiencing in California, by pretending I'd been in the land of, you know, the sitars and Krishna and Maharishi's breakthrough of consciousness.
But talking about misunderstandings based on language, I mean, of course, you're right. And in former colonies, of course, the language of the former colonizer often gets stuck in ways that become quaint because they've changed. So, you know, when you ask a Pakistani colonel or something, "How are you, colonel?" "Fighting fit, fighting fit." which reminds me of a story that it was long before that. I was in Delhi, and I read in the papers that Stephen Spender had got into slightly hot water because he'd entirely sort of meaning very well, but he'd said to an Indian journalist, it was so refreshing and lovely to be in India because people still spoke such beautifully old-fashioned English. And the Indians took umbrage to that because they thought that was deeply condescending. Mm. And I met Spender at a party in London not so much later, and just to make conversation, I didn't know what to say to the great man. I said, you know, I was in India when you were there, and I was reading in the paper about, you know, something you said, and isn't it amusing? And Spender, already being rather old and perhaps not entirely quick anymore, somehow assumed that I was an Indian. And so it was one of those conversations that started on the wrong track and got sort of fair. So everything I said to him was, yes, well, of course, in your country. And, no, no, but I love Delhi.
And yet, of course, you know, I think that opens out onto the fact that in our lifetime, we've seen, as they say, the empire striking back. And to me, as somebody who studied literature all these years, the wonderful thing is to see, for example, Indian writers taking over the heart of English literature, perhaps by bringing a certain trust in a sort of, they commanded the 19th century novel right now. And they're bringing to English literature a very different spirit from a typical English person. And a different kind of language often, and more kind of classical Dickens and Hardy themes that have reinvigorated the place. And my secret, or the literature, my secret theory is that the capital of the 19th century novel in English was London, and of the 20th century was New York. But of the 21st century writing in English, Mumbai could make a pretty good claim for being a capital.
Yeah, although I think that's a very tricky subject, because as you know, a lot of Indian writers rather resent these people who've become so successful writing in English outside India. And a lot of that resentment has to do with class. Mm-hmm. Because the people who become so successful, Salman Rushdie being a very good example, are people from an Indian upper class, educated in English either in England at public schools or private boarding schools, what they are, or in the Indian equivalent of that. And then for a sort of a non-Indian public, start writing novels that are deliberately exotic. And a lot of Indians who write in vernacular languages actually resent that because they feel these are upper-class people who are appealing to a world audience by exoticizing a culture that, in which most of them don't even live anymore because they live in New York or Rome or London. And so, yes, you're right, and I'm not saying this to put these people down because I think it has had a very bracing cosmopolitan effect on Western literature, I mean, which is altogether a good thing. But I think the British writer who lives in Italy, Tim Parks, has written quite a lot about this subject, and he says it's very difficult for. He mentions Ishiguro a lot. If you want to reach a world audience as a modern literary writer, and you're from a non-Western culture, there are two ways that it's often done. One is to, and sometimes very consciously, one is to write in a kind of English that is so, that avoids all allusions or all references to history, to other literary works of that culture and so on. That's sort of without a culture. And Ishiguro has often said that's what he does deliberately. And in some ways, Murakami Haruki does that too, even though he writes in Japanese, which is easy to translate. There are no cultural references there. Or you become deliberately exotic, and people start flying off like djinns all the time, and so on. And Tim Parks has written quite shrewdly about that. I mean, how that's... he doesn't say it's good or bad, but it is a phenomenon.
Yes. And I think what those writers would say in response is, for example, Rushdie has brought this impenitent energy and inventiveness to English and created a kind of mulligatawny mongrel English by bringing in the sounds and spices of India into English and sort of throwing open the windows of a rather stuffy Hampstead house, which is what English literature used to be. Or someone like Rohinton Mystery, who I think is one of the great humanist novelists of our time. I'm not sure how many novelists in England would attempt a 600-page kind of Zola novel at this point, or Victor Hugo novel, and he does. And it's interesting, partly because he grew up in that world that you were describing of the Pakistani and the cricket and all that. I'm wondering, were there artworks from the Asia that really changed the direction of your life or that you remember having a big effect on you?
Absolutely.
Probably a lot of them, but...
Well, no, I mean, one very specific one. When I was studying Chinese at Leiden University, I was living in Amsterdam, and there was a wonderful theater in Amsterdam, in an old movie theater, actually, called the Mikkeri Theater. And the Mikkeri Theater was run by a very remarkable man called Ritsaart ten Kate. And it became a kind of center, because of him, of world avant-garde and underground theater. Hmm. And groups from the United States. Willem Dafoe made his cut his teeth there, for example. And you had the Bread and Puppet Theater from America, and the Living Theater was there, and you had groups from France, England, Poland, India, all over the place. And I was studying Chinese, as I said, and the kind of modern Chinese that was then that we then had to read were things like, you know, the magazine Red Flag, Hung Chi, which was unbelievably boring, with sort of horrible wooden communist Chinese and so on. And so China really did not attract me then. And one of the things that I saw at Mikkeri was a group by a Japanese writer, poet, filmmaker called Terayama Shuji. Hmm. And he had a theater group called the Tenjo Sajiki. And the play they put on, and they took over the whole theater and the streets around the theater and so on, was called Ahen Senso, the Opium War. And it was the most extraordinary thing I'd ever seen. And you were led through from one room to another, and somebody was slaughtering a chicken, and people were supposedly, there was an opium den, and there were people in Japanese World War II uniforms, and there were transvestites, and there were sort of huge blown up manga on the walls, and there was music of the weirdest kind. And it was a completely different world. Mm. Of course, it was a fantasy world. And a fantasy world that sprouted from the mind of this extraordinary poet, Terayama Shuji, and who managed to turn this into the most extraordinary theatrical experience that I'd ever seen. I thought, if this is what Japan is like, I'm going to get on the next plane. Mm. Now, what was the most extraordinary thing, that when I got to Tokyo, was how much it looked like this fantasy world that I'd seen in the theater. Yeah. Because... One of the reasons, because Tokyo, of course, was bombed to smithereens, like every other Japanese city, except Kyoto and Nara. And so it was rebuilt almost entirely after the war. The 1960s was a time when many ordinary Japanese began to have money again, but not quite enough money or chance to go abroad. So what happened is that in a city like Tokyo, a kind of simulacrum of abroad was built right there. Mm. So you had sort of, I remember a coffee shop called Versailles, and you'd go underground from the Yodobashi Kamura in Shinjuku, and you'd go down sort of concrete steps, and suddenly you were in a Versailles palace. Of course, it was all made of plastic and plywood, but there were sort of, you know, candelabras and marble walls and so on. And then there were, you know, there were Italian coffee shops, there were mock Tudor places, there were love hotels in the shape of a Disney castle. The whole place was like, as Donald Ritchie once said, they don't need Disneyland in Japan, they've got it right there, it's Tokyo.
Yeah, yeah.
And this was, much of that was the fantasy stuff, was built in the 60s. Mm. And all that was still there when I got there. So in some ways, the culture shock that I had in LA prepared me for this, because it was like a very, very dense version of LA, where, of course, you had the same fantasies of baronial and Tudor and Spanish, Moroccan, and all that kind. And the whole of the center of Tokyo, in some ways, was like that, which made it look like a kind of Terayama Shuji stage set. I loved it.
And I think that's part of what accounts for the abiding strangeness of Japan, because it's the things that are meant to be familiar that's strangest of all. They're not just lost in translation, they're remade in translation. And that's why when my friends arrive in Kyoto, and I, of course, take them immediately to McDonald's, and they see that there are moon-viewing burgers on the menu. And most of all, when they turn away from the menu, they see that the way people are speaking or not speaking or covering their mouths when they laugh, or the whole body language and so much of the social language is as Japanese as it would have been in the 16th century. So every notion about how this is a Western place gets upended, but it's not exactly an Eastern place, and you know, one's
no, but Tokyo, of course, is very traditional, and we Tokyoites always rather despised Kyoto. And
Kyoto.
And foreigners who lived in Kyoto. I remember we always made fun of this American woodblock artist called Karhu, who always went around in a kimono and sort of probably lighting joss sticks and things. Yeah. And I always affected to despise Kyoto. I secretly quite liked it. But the last time I was there, which was actually in January this year, I decided I actually liked Kyoto. But it's become weirder, because I would go to the Kiyomizu-dera and these sort of famous old temples, and I saw that half the young people were dressed in kimonos. And I thought, my God, they've become traditional again in Japan. And they were all Chinese.
Yes, I was going to say that, yes. Yeah.
It's Chinese tour groups, and it's part of their thing that they can get dressed up in.
Yes. And it's also, I mean, as you know, it's an interesting aspect of this cross-cultural pollination that the geisha industry in Kyoto, I think, was revived by the book written here, Memoirs of a Geisha. And now all my friends, when they arrive in Kyoto, say, we saw 100 geisha there today. And they're young women from the Japanese countryside who pay $150 to dress up as a geisha. So Japan itself has become a fantasy country for the Japanese.
Right.
And then we partake. We don't know where the reality stops and where it ends. And one thing that I'm amused by, because as you said, let's say in the 60s or 70s, Buddhism was a great lure for people to go to Kyoto.
Not for me.
No, but for the Clifford Kahus of the world.
Right.
Now, I sort of feel that Shinto has stolen into the public consciousness. When I read Marie Kondo, who's sitting probably atop the bestseller list still, I think the house cleaning tips that she's bringing into this country have a lot to do with Shinto. Or when I see Miyazaki Hayao's movies, Spirited Away or The Wind Rises. It's interesting, you know, two of the most prominent cultural figures from Japan right now are the two HMs, Haruki Murakami that Ian was talking about, and Hayao Miyazaki. And I feel that Murakami is speaking for this placeless post-war world where there's Miles Davis on the sound system and everyone's eating pasta. And in some sense, they've lost a sense of direction and identity. And Miyazaki, meanwhile, is trying to excavate all these spirits that live in the traditional Japanese way, saturating every desk and glass of water. And there's an interesting tug of war because they're sort of pushing into different directions and towards different centuries.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of Murakami, but I do think he's very interesting because he represents something which says something about Asia especially, but not only Asia, because he's popular everywhere and for good reasons. But I think he says something about especially the richer parts of East and Southeast Asia, Singapore, Hong Kong, China today, Japan, which is that many young people since the 70s really rebelled against living the extended family and all the duties that entails. You have to behave as a perfect family person. The wife has to obey the mother-in-law, etc. And the dream of young Japanese wives since the 70s was to be in a nuclear family. And they would often end up on the 15th floor of some ghastly housing project, sort of, you know, drinking in the middle of the day, watching TV. But nonetheless, that's what they wanted. Mm. And so to be free, to be an individual, was to break away from the family. Mm. And I think that's had huge effects on life in Southeast and East Asia, because often it ended up in relative isolation. Mm. And that's what Murakami rarely describes. Mm. It's always, you know, a man and a woman in some well and with nobody else around and so on. And I think it really speaks to people. And in some ways, when Japanese, certainly in the 70s, would often say to me, it must be very lonely in the West because everybody's so individual, and we Japanese, we all have our families and so on. In some ways, I think it rather become the opposite, that in Europe at least, but even in America, families in some ways are closer and people have more friends and so on than the people who thirsted freedom but didn't know how to cope with it.
Yes.
In East and in Southeast Asia, and which is sad. I mean, I'm sure that'll pass, but it's been exacerbated, I think, because of the internet and the social media that, and you see these young Japanese women in coffee shops together with their friends, and they're not talking to one another. They're just going
Yeah, I mean, there are, as you know, there are 400 internet rescue camps in China alone where cold turkey is administered to kids who are literally suffering from internet addiction. I think the Korean novel that came out here, translated as Please Look After Mom, caught what you describe exactly, the predicament of really a culture with one foot out the door and the other, and about an elderly Korean woman adrift in Seoul trying to find her children. It speaks for the family having been exploded, the nuclear family. There's so much more I think we could be saying, but we should open it up to you now.
Absolutely, no, I think that's a great idea. We've come to an opportunity to have a Q&A, and I believe we have microphones to for our audience members, just to make sure that the question is heard. So I think we have our first question right here.
The one thing you haven't mentioned is manga and anime, which so captivates Westerners. We have a 12-year-old granddaughter living in London, and she's, you know, Gambetta, and she's going on and on about this, and, you know, goth fashions, all the things you would see in Tokyo.
I don't have a huge amount to say about it. I've never been, myself, an enormous fan of anime and manga. But it is a very interesting phenomenon, and especially how it's become such a worldwide thing. I think there's a long tradition in Japan of sort of proto-manga. And if you look at illustrated stories and so on from the Edo period, you can already see that kind of sensibility. So it didn't start there for nothing. But I don't have anything terribly fresh or original to say on the topic.
And there's a great book called Japan America, as you may know, by somebody who's half Japanese and half American, goes back and forth between New York and Tokyo, explaining that world from within. I spent a little time a couple of years ago with Takashi Murakami, who's fascinating because all he does is this over-the-top, deliberately flamboyant kind of manga work. And yet the more time I spent with him, the more I found he was deeply Japanese. And in fact, he was using this to try and wake Japan up from its post-war stupor and deliberately violent, grotesque images as a way to say, where are we going? Of course, not every 12-year-old is going to pick up on that, but there's some interesting things going on in
I can say one thing. I mean, it's always after the question when you start to think that you have an answer, but the one interesting thing is that in Japan, adults read manga too. And I think, and this of course also goes back into history, and Japan is unlike China in that respect. In China, I think low culture and high culture are very distinct. If you're a literati, in the literati circles, you were involved in a certain kind of high culture and you wouldn't do popular culture. In Japan, if you were not born in the upper class, if you were born in the merchant class or something, you did popular culture, whether it was woodblock prints or anything else, that you stuck to that. You didn't move on to a literati kind of art, which is why it became so refined in Japan. But it also means that I think that the distinction between high and low culture is much less pronounced, and people, adults, not only today, but a long time ago, felt absolutely no embarrassment about sitting on a subway reading a manga. Whereas in Europe, an adult reading a comic book would be slightly strange. Maybe not anymore, but at one point it would have been regarded as somewhat childish. And I don't think that that was the case in Japan, and I do think that there are that has said something about the culture.
And it's also a culture that's used to thinking in terms of images. Mm. I was tickled when I got maybe 3 extra followers on Twitter recently, and then I saw that Kumamon, a Japanese cartoon bear, has 420,000 followers on Twitter, so puts things in perspective.
Hi, my name's Ling. Thank you for the wonderful talk. And my question is, when I first started to use social media, I noticed that my friends in the East often have profile pictures of cute animals or their children or places they've been. by my friends in America overhead themselves. But then you have this phenomena called selfie, and you have everybody across the globe photographing themselves. And can you talk about sort of this differences in self-expression and what the internet has done to the gap between East and West? Thank you.
I don't know if there is such a huge gap. I mean, maybe. It's not something I've put a lot of thought. I mean, it seems to me that all over the world, more and more people spend their time sort of pressed together with others, sort of going like that. And I find it sort of fascinating because I think what the internet, what the social media have done is to encourage narcissism. And I don't think that there is a great gap between East and West. I think people in the East don't need to be encouraged, and nor do they in the West. People naturally gravitate towards narcissism. What is more interesting is that for every narcissist, there's a sucker-upper. And so I find it fascinating when you look at Facebook, and every time you see, and I won't mention any names, but a well-known writer who does a festival in India or something, going, my latest review, terrific. And then you get sort of 100 Indians saying, wonderful, way to go, you're a genius. And so I find the human desire to suck up is just as strong as the human desire to show how wonderful they are.
No more trips to Jaipur for you, Ian. My response would just be that the internet hasn't created, it's just made globally visible what I see as some differences between cultures. You may know there's a person called Richard Nisbet who does cultural anthropology, and he will show people from East Asia and people from California this table, and generally speaking, the people from East Asia will focus on the background, and the people from California will focus on the foreground, and many differences like that, just about perspective, which would perhaps be why people are showing, representing themselves by things other than themselves in the avatars or icons you were referring to at the beginning.
Hello, can you comment on Japan's depopulation and the advent of robot culture?
Yeah, you go ahead.
Well, they have 2.5 dimensional characters in Japan, which is another one of those aspects that reminds you, to me, how different it is from most of the cultures I notice. I think the notion of, for example, the people who impersonate cartoon characters in cafes in certain parts of Tokyo are doing something that we would not aspire to do, which is taking one or half a dimension out of ourselves. People have get married with a robot presiding instead of a priest. And I don't think that's strange necessarily to those people. It's more just speaks for a different way of their conceiving of things. The famous example that was used a few years ago was that when an elderly couple in Japan don't have grandparents or grandkids to come and visit them on Sundays for the reasons that Ian was describing, they would hire actresses to come and impersonate them and come and visit them every Sunday. Hi, Grandad. Hi, Grandpa. You know, how great it is to see you and what you've been up to, and I hope you're well. And to us, that sounds strange. But if you're prepared to make the leap of faith that this person is a representative of what you want from a grandchild, not strange at all.
But to most Japanese, that would be pretty strange too, I would imagine.
Well, I think less strange there than here, because when I go to my convenience store, my sense is I'm not meeting an individual. I'm meeting somebody who has trained herself very well to act as the generic platonic model of a convenience store worker. I notice when I go back and forth between California and Japan and 7-Elevens, it's a very pronounced difference in the nature of transactions. So the Japanese person is more trained, encouraged to disappear into the role.
But how different is that from a lonely, middle-aged American male who truly believes that the call girl who comes to visit him really loves him?
Yeah, well, there's a... Yeah, that's a $64 million question, I think.
It's great to see both of you. Vishaka Desai. Mm-hmm. I want to turn the question on to both of you. You've really described amazingly well your positioning both as insiders, outsiders, belonging, non-belonging. I would love to hear from both of you, as is true of many of us, how do you think of yourself in terms of your identity or identities, and in sense of belonging, non-belonging, where does identity fit into that question?
That's a beautiful question. And I remember when I was a little boy growing up in Oxford, England, and then moving to California at the age of 7, I thought I was in a relatively unusual and privileged position that I didn't belong entirely to any culture, but I had pieces of 3 within me. And that to some extent, when I looked at an auditorium like this, I wasn't looking at it as a typical Indian, if such a creature exists, or as a typical Californian, or as a typical English person, but I could choose, or I could mix and match, I could create new combinations. And I never imagined then what seemed so unusual in 1964 to become the norm. I would say that's the defining characteristic of our culture and our individuals in the 21st century. And in terms of, and you know, I never dreamed that a half Kenyan, half Kansan who had grown up in Indonesia would be officially the most powerful person in the world. And I think intuitively, though I probably couldn't have articulated this, I began to see that it made more sense to define myself by my passions than my passport. And that if I called myself an Indian, maybe I'd be opposing myself to Pakistan. Or if I said in those days I'm an American, maybe I'd be thinking of Cuba or Vietnam as evil empires. Or if I said I was British, people from Britain's colonies, former colonies, might rightly see me as an oppressor. But if I tried to define myself in less tribal ways, having less to do with nation states, then perhaps there's a possibility of stepping out of a few of those ancient us versus them divisions. We all know that they haven't gone away, but we also all know that a whole new floating culture has come into being, whether it's world literature, world music, fusion cuisine, or just many of the people in this room who can't and won't define themselves in traditional terms. And as you know, now that number comes to 230 million, and it's increasing so quickly that in a generation it's expected there'll be 460 million people with multiple homes. So that'll represent the third largest nation on Earth, and there'll be many more people of that kind than there are Americans. So of course most Americans are traditionally like that too. So I like the way that the notion of identity has been not just expanded, but in some ways exploded, and that we can't fall back on the easy ways we would describe ourselves. In my grandparents' generation, all 4 of my grandparents were born in India, and it was almost as if they were given these little cards saying, this is your caste, this is your religion, this is your race, this is your tribe, these are friends on this side of the road, those are your enemies on the other side of the road, and you'll always be locked within this framework. And I think the beauty of the Age of Movement is, on the one hand, it's brought the fanatics of every culture to every other culture, on the other hand, it's freed us from certain of those parochialisms.
Yeah, I couldn't have said it better, and I feel about myself the same way Pico does about himself. But there is, of course, a darker side to this, which is that that very phenomenon is also, to many people, deeply frightening. And a lot of people who will vote for Trump, who's, of course, a typical German, are scared to death of this very thing, because they feel their country, the one thing that they felt they had was a certain privilege because they were, you know, the real Americans and so on, is slipping away in this world of more fluid identities. And, you know, the backlash is here, and it's not going to be pretty.
Yeah. Well, in Europe, even more so. You wrote that book, Murder in Amsterdam.
I don't know about even more so.
Yeah?
I think it's a very similar thing.
Mm.
But one thing I would say is that, speaking entirely for myself, I think it's had an enormous effect on the way I write, because growing up in a mixed household, culturally mixed household, certainly at a time when it was less common, as Pico says, gives you a certain sensibility that you're always standing slightly at an odd angle, and you're always trying to, you become very interested in how people from another side see things. And so in that sense, me trying to figure out the British side of my family and how they saw the world is not so different from the way I try and figure out how people in Japan or Thailand or, so you try and get into the mind of other people, and that's, of course, why we write.
Pico, if you would indulge us by answering the question of whether there's a particular work of art or a performance or an experience that you've had. I think we had the pleasure of hearing Ian's, but did you have an answer to that question?
too many as a sort of lifelong student of literature. It's interesting. I mean, one thing I've been thinking about, and this is slightly off the topic of art, but we always ask the question about whether cross-culturalism is conducive to peace. And as Ian was just saying, not always. But I've had the fortune of spending 42 years traveling and talking with the Dalai Lama. And it's interesting how his global experiences have reminded him forcibly of how great the distances between cultures are. And some of you may know he was at the Glastonbury Festival, music festival, in England last year. And somebody asked him whether music was conducive to world peace. And he said, well, it's possible, but try it in Syria or Iraq. And in other words, we have a long, long way to go before literature can create really substantial bridges. I think for me, you know, books like A Fine Balance by Rohinton Mistry, in which he takes the classic English novel, creates a Bombay that probably has been romanticized or is the creation of his imagination because he's been living in Toronto for more than 40 years. But by virtue of that distance from Bombay, he can see certain things that somebody caught up in the middle of the chaos would not. And then essentially recreating the classic 19th century novel in the country of his birth. That kind of thing has been really moving to me. Because I felt when I was studying literature in graduate school in the 70s, English literature seemed to have come to rather a dead end. And we didn't know where to go beyond George Eliot and T.S. Eliot. And then 3 years later, there was Michael Ondaatje hymning into being, for example, in The English Patient, this new Oasis Society, which, as Ian is saying, is threatening to many people. But I love the fact that in The English Patient, the English patient almost dies in war because he's not English. And the woman called Hannah has this wonderful name, which could be Czech or Japanese, or in fact what it is, Canadian. And the person who's fighting for the British army is a Sikh who's risking his life for the Brits. And the guy called Caravaggio loses his finger to an Italian. So in other words, a novel like that in 1992 was announcing we can't use the old terminology anymore. World War II took nationalism in certain ways to a very destructive end, and what are the possibilities for creating a new society in the desert where we're not thinking about tribes so much. So I like the way, you know, my sense is that cultures and individuals are often much more nuanced than our governments or our corporations, and I trust them more for breaking through the us versus them than corporations or governments that define themselves by the other. So when novelists like Michael Ondaatje imagine a new kind of society, I'm even more excited than when the Prime Minister of Canada does that.
I think there are two ways of thinking about building bridges and people coming together in culture and sports and so on, and which is rather relevant now that Russian and British football supporters are sort of beating each other up in France. That when the Baron de Coubertin started the modern Olympic Games in the beginning of the 20th century, and his whole ideal was that if people can play games and sports together, the nations will come together, this will be the great bridge between peoples, they'll learn to understand one another, it'll be a great festival of international peace and brotherhood, which was very much, of course, part of the idealism of the time. Now, his greatest opponent was a man called Charles Maurras, who was the founder of the Action Française, which was a very reactionary, ultra-right-wing, anti-Semitic organization. And he saw it as a kind of Anglo-Saxon plot, and he was totally against it and so on. And then he sort of started to think again. He said, no, let them play sports, and they'll all hate each other even more. And both things are sort of true.
That takes us back to where we met at the Olympic Games.
Indeed,
seeing so. Nationalism
yeah.
Yeah, and
that's
international collide.
Arc.
Yes, yeah.
Great to join you on stage. I liked that you both sort of ended with this image of building a bridge, and I think many of us that work in cultural exchange have this idea of connecting with a bridge. But one idea and one image I would like to leave everybody with today is that I think ACC as an organization, we like to think of more than a bridge, we like to think of scaffolding, because right now the world needs connections, and being connected from one point to another and having overlapping interests and connections and relationships, I think truly can
bring peace to the world and make the world a better place. This conversation has been incredibly stimulating and interesting, and I think one of the things we had hoped for with the East-West Dialogues was that the conversation would continue. So with that, I would like to thank Ian Buruma and Pico Iyer for this stimulating, wonderful conversation. And I would like to invite you all to continue the conversation at our reception and book signing outside. Thank you again.